Hey kids, it's great to see you today. Thanks for checking back in with us. I hope you've been having a great summer. I know I have. Even though things are a little bit different, we're still having some fun, especially in GFC Kids, because we've been learning all about faith. Do you remember what faith is? I'll give you just a second to think about it. You've got it. Faith is believing in what you can't see because of what you can see. And so we've been talking about that all summer long, and we've still got a couple of more weeks that we'll be learning some more about it. But the bottom line is this: we can't see God, we can't see Jesus, but we can see the results of their work. It's kind of like a couple of weeks ago, I told you to jump up and down. You know, you jumped up in the air, but you came back down. You didn't just float off into outer space. That's because of gravity. And you can't see gravity, you just see the results of it. It's kind of like when the wind blows. You don't actually see the wind, but you see the results of it because the leaves and the limbs begin to move back and forth and things like that. Well, that's what faith is. We don't actually see it, but we see the results of it. So that's how we have to look at faith. It's believing in what we can't see because of what we can see. I can see how God's blessed us. I can see how much Jesus loves me. Those are the things that I trust in. But we'll talk about that some more in a minute. But today, I thought we would have a fun little game time. But it's not just me today. I've invited the help of a friend. His name is Mike. Now, this game is pretty self-explanatory, so just check it out and enjoy the game with Mike today. That was fun. I hope you guys enjoyed playing that game with Mike. Although I will say, I'm not too sure about him choosing the cat food over the dog food. It makes me worry about this dog. But anyway, hey, look, it's time to worship. So I want you to get up on your feet and let's sing these songs out together. Let's start it off with Happy Day.
Oh, happy day, happy day. You wash my sin away.
Death has beaten you, how rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. and to cross the empty grave. Life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. Joy and perfect peace. Earthly pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. He's alive.
Kids, let's take just a minute and bow our heads and close our eyes and pray. And remember, when we pray, we're talking to God. And so we can tell Him anything and everything, whatever's on your heart, whatever has maybe been creating some anxieties in your own life, or maybe just something that you've been thinking about and just not sure of, you can ask God about it. So just talk to Him right now as we pray together. All right, let's go. Lord Jesus, thank you so much for the day. Thank you for loving us and saving us. Thank you for this time to be able to spend it with these incredible kids. And so today we ask you to help me, Lord, that you would give me the words I need to clearly communicate to the kids the lesson, Lord, in a way that they would understand it, know how to apply it, and understand what it means. And then, God, we ask you to continue to be with our church, be with Pastor Roy, our leaders, as they have decisions to make constantly about leading our church. And so I pray that your hand would be on their lives and just give them clarity of thought and, Lord, the wisdom that they need. Lord, we're excited that we're getting so close to beginning the new building over at 325. So we just ask for your continued favor in that whole situation. God, thank you again for loving us. God, I pray that you'll continue to bless our families. And Lord, we're going to sing one more song, and this is just our way of saying thank you for all that you've done for us and just our way of expressing our love and gratitude to you. So we ask all these things in your name. Amen. All right, kids, one more song, and then we'll get into the lesson.
We won't give in or give out. We won't give up or back down. No matter what stands against us, we know our God is stronger. This life is like a race we're meant to run, and no matter what. face you overcome. And even when there's mountains in our way, we'll trust in you, 'cause you alone will be our strength. We won't give in or give out. We won't give up or back down. No matter what stands against us, we know we won't lose heart or lose hope. Our God is in control. No matter what stands against us, we know our God is stronger. And when it seems the mountain is too high, we'll still believe, 'cause you are on our side. Even when we're tired and we feel like giving up, we know we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. We won't give in or give out. We won't give up or back down. No matter what stands against us, we know we won't lose heart or lose hope. Our God is in control. No matter what stands against us, we know our God is stronger. Greater is He who is on our side, on our side. Greater is He who is on our side than anything that stands against us. Greater is He who is on our side, on our side. Greater is He who is on our side than anything that stands against us. We won't give in or give out. We won't give up or back down. No matter what stands against us, we know we won't lose heart or lose hope. Our God is in control. No matter what stands against us, we know our God is stronger.
Well, good job singing today, kids. Well, listen, there's a guy that we read about in the Bible that had some pretty crazy stuff happen to him. Some pretty wild things. And we've actually been talking about him for the last couple of weeks. I'm talking about the Apostle Paul. And we know him as having written over half of the New Testament. But Paul had a pretty crazy life. He had some wild things happen. It seemed like he was always in danger, because he was so passionate and so bold about sharing the gospel of Jesus. And so today, just to help us out, I thought, when I started thinking about Paul and some of the dangers that he faced, it made me think that it should be a movie. So we've recruited the help of a movie trailer voiceover man. So let's let him introduce the movie or the story today.
In a world full of angry people, one courageous man was willing to tell others about Jesus, even if he got beaten up, made fun of, and tossed into jail. The legend, the man of faith, Paul.
See, it sounds just like a movie trailer, doesn't it? I mean, Paul's life was like a movie. He was beaten up, he was thrown in jail, he was chased out of so many different towns. It seemed like everywhere he went, people were chasing him around just for sharing the good news of the gospel. But finally, Paul comes to Jerusalem. And when he gets there, again, the people, they're wanting to kill Paul. So believe it or not, the soldiers actually arrested Paul and threw him in jail just to save his life. It wasn't that they wanted to arrest him because of some illegal activity. It was just they were trying to keep the people in town from killing him. So I can't imagine how scary that might have been for Paul. I mean, knowing that people are trying to kill you and now you're sitting in this jail. But Jesus, while Paul was in jail, Jesus appeared to him and he told Paul, he said, look, just be brave. Just trust me. And so he knew that Paul had been so bold and brave to share the good news of Jesus already and all over the place. But God still had some pretty amazing plans for Paul's life. So he wasn't finished with him. And he knew in order to do that, Paul would need to have great courage. So Paul is there in prison. He's now been visited by Jesus. And since the people were plotting to kill him, Paul had the idea, hey, take me before the governor. And Paul was in Caesarea, so he goes before the governor and he makes a request. He asks them to allow him to travel to Rome and stand trial there before Caesar. And so the governor of Caesarea, he approved this, but he said, you're not going to go by yourself. I'm going to have Julius, one of my chief commanders, he will escort you on this journey and make sure that you're not just trying to pull a fast one on us, you know. So here they go, they set sail, and it was almost like a pirate movie here, you know, because here they are getting on this big ship and hitting the open seas. But I gotta say, Julius was a pretty nice soldier because along the way, he even allowed Paul to stop in Sidon and see some of his friends there and talk with them. And so from there, they set sail from Sidon to Cyprus. And when they got there, they transferred to a ship from Egypt. Now, this ship was full of grain, and they were actually headed to Italy. And so let's just go ahead. Why don't we set sail with them? Well, this ship, it fought the seas and the winds and the waves for many, many days. I can't imagine what it must have been like back then on those big wooden ships just going through the open water like that. But eventually, they came to the island of Crete in a little town called Fair Havens. And Paul could see that the longer that they sailed, the more dangerous it was becoming. He could tell that the weather was changing, and he wanted everyone to know what was coming. So listen at what he told the passengers of this ship in Acts chapter 27 and verse 10. He stood before them and he said, "Men, I can see that our trip is going to be dangerous. The ship and everything in it will be lost. Our own lives will be in danger as well." So the captain and the ship's owner, they wanted to reach a better harbor to keep the ship safe and protected even through the winter months. So they wanted to reach a town called Phoenix. But a gentle wind began to blow, and the ship's crew thought, well, man, we've got a good breeze going. Hoist the sails, matey, let's hit the seas again. And they thought, hey, let's just take off. They totally disregarded Paul's warning. Paul had already told them this wasn't a good time to travel and that they would be in danger. But the thing is, they set sail, and this gentle wind, well, it grew worse. It kept going until it was almost like the force of a hurricane, and the ship was caught in this horrible, terrible storm. Man, can you imagine being on this wooden ship? The horror of hearing all that wind and these huge waves crashing into the sides of the ship. And the men did whatever they could to try to save the ship. They brought the lifeboat on board to the ship, and they actually ran ropes underneath the ship to try to hold it together. And I can't imagine the fear that was in these guys' minds right now. They begin to take the cargo and just throw it overboard, get everything that has weight to it off the ship so we can stay afloat. And in the midst of all of this chaos, God sent an angel to Paul. And here's the movie trailer voice man to tell us about that.
In a world where a ship is in great danger, God sends an angel to one man just to encourage him. The angel explains that God will save the lives of everyone on board.
Well, the next morning, after this angel had appeared to Paul, he addressed all 276 passengers of this ship, and he stood by them and he told them what the angel had actually told him. So he told them, he said, look, just be brave. Just trust God, because they actually, and this is where it sounds weird, but they needed to crash the ship onto the beach of an island just in order to survive. Well, as you might imagine, nobody liked that idea. Here we are in the middle of this horrible storm and we're trying to hold the boat together, and you're wanting me to crash it? Well, on the 14th night of this storm, they discovered that they were close to land. So the crew members, they were afraid of crashing. So that lifeboat that they had pulled up earlier, well, they let it back down in the water. And so the plan was they were going to escape and leave Paul and the other passengers behind. But Paul told Julius and his soldiers, he said, look, the only way that we can stay alive is to stay on this ship. So the soldiers decided to trust Paul, which was a huge deal. I mean, he's a prisoner, but they trusted what he was saying. So they did a hard thing. That lifeboat, they cut the ropes and just let it drift off into the open ocean. So here they were, and they survived the night. Excuse me. And the next morning, Paul, in the midst of this ship going back and forth and up and down, and I'm sure they were all getting seasick, but Paul's like, hey, man, I'm hungry. So he got some bread, and he began to break the bread and share it with everyone there, and they ate. And they gave thanks to God for allowing them to be safe up to this point. So the crew now listened to Paul, and they ran the ship up onto the beach. Sounds like a good time for the movie trailer voice man again.
In a world where it seems like you should do whatever you can to save the ship, one man leads the crew and his fellow passengers to run their ship onto a beach. The ship may break apart into pieces, but this man of God, he trusts God's promise that everyone will survive.
Well, after they crashed on the beach, the soldiers, they decided, look, we've been through so much. Now it's time for us just to go ahead. We need to kill Paul, and we need to kill those other prisoners because they may try to escape from this island, or they may try to swim off. But when Julius caught wind of that, he stopped him because he wanted to save Paul's life. So sure enough, now they've all reached the beach of this island safely, just like Paul had said they would. And when they landed on this island called Malta, there were some people there, and they welcomed them and even built a fire. So as Paul was there, you know, I imagine they're wet, maybe a little bit cold. It's getting close to winter. So I don't know. I just kind of imagine that Paul may have grabbed a stick or something just to kind of stoke the fire a little bit. And when he did, of all things, a snake got him right on the hand and bit him. The Bible says it was a viper. And so all he did was simply shake the snake off back into the fire. Can you imagine that? If a snake had bit me on the hand, I'd have screamed like a woman, but not Paul. He was a manly man, and he just shook it off into the fire, and nothing happened. And the people around him saw this, and they're like, he must be a god because he's not even injured. And so the chief of the island, he saw this, and he was amazed. And so he invited Paul and some of the others to come into his house just to get off the beach. And so when they arrived there, Paul realized that the chief's father was very, very sick. So he went in before the chief's father and prayed for him that God would heal him. And you know what? He did. And so the people of Malta, they were so happy. And so they just could not thank Paul enough for all that he had done. So they gave him all of these supplies to help him and the others continue to make their journey. And eventually he made it to Rome. And there was another group of believers when he got to Rome. They were there to welcome him, and they were happy to see him. But man, what a story when you think about all that's happened in just this short amount of time in the life of Paul. I mean, doesn't it sound like some kind of weird, crazy movie that we would see coming out in the next Avengers series or something? And that's what Paul lived every single day. But as we wrap this up, let's hear from our movie trailer voiceover man one more time.
In a world where one man has endured storms, death threats, snakes, and angry mobs, that same man has now made it to Rome. Now, under guard in a home, he will boldly share the good news of Jesus with everyone who visits him.
So yeah, Paul is back at Rome now, but he's still under guard. But he wasn't in jail. He got to stay in a house. And it's kind of neat to think about it that at this point, Paul has spent 2 years of his life boldly going into places and sharing the gospel with all these different people and all these different countries. There were so many times when Paul had to run for his life. There were so many times where Paul could have just given up. I mean, you think about all that he's gone through just in our story today, but Paul's been arrested, he's been beaten, he's been chased out of town by angry mobs, he's been thrown in prison, he's just went through a hurricane, he's been bitten by a snake. I would imagine there was some times where Paul could have very easily given up. I know I would have wanted to. But through all of the problems, Paul never gave up because he knew this. Knowing Jesus changes the way that you see your problems. See, Paul didn't see his problems as something that was going to stop him. He knew that Jesus was always with him. And you know what? The same is true for me and you. No matter what we're facing, no matter what we're going through, whether it's going through this season of coronavirus, whether it's staying at home to have to do school, or maybe it's doing school a little bit different this year, no matter what we face, God is with us. And when we remember that, our problems, they're just not that big, and we know that we can make it with God's help.
The Bible, it's 66 books of history, stories, letters, and poetry that fit together to form God's one big story. The epic adventure of how he created us and loves us so much that he made a way to rescue us. As we travel through the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, we discover people who met God and found their lives changed forever. Now, for an amazing story, inspired by the book of Acts, chapters 27 and 28.
Paul faced many difficult days because he taught so boldly about Jesus. He was beaten, made fun of, thrown into jail, and run out of town. At last, in Jerusalem, Paul was arrested by Roman soldiers after a mob tried to kill him.
He speaks against our law!
Get rid of that guy!
Paul paced in his prison cell. The Lord stood next to him.
Be brave. You have told people about me in Jerusalem. You must do the same in Rome.
Because a group of Jews were plotting to kill him, Paul was taken to the governor in Caesarea. From there, he was ordered to Rome to stand trial before Caesar. Then, he was handed off to a Roman commander for the sea journey.
I am Julius of the Imperial Guard. I am very imperious, but also a reasonable human being.
Glad to hear it.
Julius allowed Paul to visit with friends as they stopped at the port city of Sidon. From there, they sailed around Cyprus, transferred to a ship from Egypt, carrying grain to Italy. The ship fought against the wind for many days until they arrived in a town on the island of Crete called Fair Havens. It was already well into October, a risky time for sea travel.
Men, I can see that our trip is going to be dangerous. The ship will be lost and our own lives will be in danger.
A reasonable concern.
The pilot and ship's owner wanted to reach a better harbor for the winter.
Pish posh. We can make it to Phoenix.
Well...
Feel that? Gentle southerly breeze. Perfection.
We leave at once!
Anchors away!
But very soon, the gentle breeze transformed. Within a short time, the wind beat against the ship with the strength of a hurricane. The pilot gave up fighting the gale.
Hoist the lifeboat! Secure ropes around the bow. Jettison the cargo.
In the midst of the chaos, the Lord sent an angel to Paul. The next morning, Paul withstood the storm to encourage the crew and passengers. 276 people.
Not to say I told you so, but I told you so. Second, not a problem. Last night, an angel from God told me, "Do not be afraid, Paul. You must go on trial in front of Caesar. God has shown his grace by sparing the lives of all those sailing with you. But we must run the ship onto an island."
On the 14th night of the storm, the sailors realized they were nearing land.
"The water is only 90 feet deep here.
Drop the anchor."
The crew was so afraid of crashing against the rocks that they lowered the lifeboats, planning to escape and leave the passengers.
"Julius, these men must stay with the ship. If they don't, you can't be saved."
"A reasonable request. Cut the ropes!"
The soldiers cut the ropes so the crew could not escape. Just before dawn, Paul gathered everyone on board, shouting above the wind,
Not a problem. None of you will lose a single hair from your head. Now, I'm asking you to eat so you can live.
Paul took bread and thanked God. He then broke the bread and ate it. Everyone was filled with hope while they had some food to eat as the gray morning dawned.
There's the beach! Lift the anchors and we'll run her aground!
But as the pilot steered desperately for shore, the ship hit a sandbar and began to break into pieces. The soldiers were planning to kill Paul and the other prisoners to keep them from swimming to freedom.
Stop! Don't hurt them! Paul must live! Everyone overboard! Swim to land or grab a piece of the wreckage!
Miraculously, everyone made it to shore, just as God had promised.
Welcome to Malta!
The people of Malta were unusually kind as they built a fire to welcome this large group of wet and stranded visitors.
I'll fetch some more firewood.
Paul tossed sticks into the fire. Then, a deadly snake slithered out and sunk his teeth into Paul's hand.
This man must be a murderer. The gods won't let him live.
Not a problem. Totally fine.
Paul simply shook the snake into the fire. When the people saw he was unharmed, they decided he was a god. Publius, a chief official, welcomed Paul and the others into his home.
Take whatever you need.
Paul discovered that Publius, his father, was very sick. So he prayed.
Jesus, please, heal this man.
Publius, his father, was made well. All the sick people on the island flocked to see Paul, and they too were healed. Paul had so much respect on Malta that when it was time to leave, the people of Malta gave him all the supplies they needed.
Bon voyage!
At long last, Paul neared Rome. The believers had heard he was on his way and traveled to meet him.
Welcome to Rome!
I thank God for you all.
In Rome, Paul was allowed to live in his own home, under guard. For 2 years, he welcomed anyone who came to see him. He told Jews and Gentiles alike the good news of Jesus, just as God promised he would.
Look, God is in control of every single aspect of our lives. As I sit here and teach, I have no control over my sight. I have no control over my heart pumping blood through my body right now. God's in control of all of that. I have no control of the weather outside right now. God's in control of that. And that was certainly true for Paul. Everything that he was going through, he had no control over that. God was in control. And we all have problems. Every single one of us, I know I do. But we can face our problems with the same courage that Paul had because we know that God is in control and God is with us. So we can be just as confident as Paul was. See, Paul was determined to continue to do what God had called him to do, and that was to share the good news about Jesus. And because Paul trusted God, he could face his problems head on without worry. Nothing could stop him, not even trials, shipwrecks, or snakes. Paul understood that Jesus is the one that God's big story is all about. He had faith that Jesus really is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. He understood that no matter what problems he faced, they were worth it for him to share about Jesus. And that's what we need to do. Trust God and remember that he is with us even when we face problems in life. And when we do that, it changes things because knowing Jesus, well, it changes the way that you and I see our problems. So if you're going through a hard time at school and feel like you're alone, remember, God's with you. When you're sick or you get hurt, remember, God is with you. When a friend moves away or you lose someone that you care about, just remember, God is with you. See, knowing Jesus, it's a very powerful gift that helps us see our problems in a completely different way. And so we can have faith in him. Remember, faith is believing and what we can't see because of what we can see. So even when things aren't going our way, we can trust Jesus. Remember our memory verse? If you don't, let's put it up on the screen because our memory verse just reminds us that God's grace has saved you because of your faith in Christ. Your salvation doesn't come from anything you do. It's God's gift. So just remember, Jesus is absolutely the best gift we've ever been given. And you and I just need to have faith in Him. Even though we can't see Him, we can trust in Him because of the things that we can see as a result of Him working in the lives and in the world around us, okay? Well, look, kids, thanks for listening today and checking in with us. I've enjoyed hanging out with you. And I look forward to being with you next week. So be sure to check in. If I don't see you at church, I'll see you online. But before we go, right hand up in the air, high five. I'll see you next week.